Remain seated and come to order.
Proceed when you're ready.
Judge, a couple of housekeeping matters before we can begin back with the witness. I had realized during the break that actually there's 17 exhibits in your package. Number 17 is the PowerPoint presentation that another witness will go through that we discussed in the pretrial conference.
I don't have any objection to that, Joe.
So stupid.
All right. Sheriff, when we took the break, I was asking you about your budget book, which is our Exhibit 12 that's in evidence, and you have the budget book there with you. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Right. First question I have for you is, when did you first present that to the Board of Commissioners for consideration as your 18 budget?
I believe that was July the 5th when we presented to the board.
Right. And that was a budget hearing, a public hearing?
That's correct.
All right. Tell the judge what steps you went through to put together Exhibit 12, your 2018 budget book.
Well, in April, approximately April and even before, we began during our weekly command staff meetings discussing the budget in preparation of what we need. This is being an employee of the previous sheriff for past 13 or so years. One do things a little bit different. I want to include our command staff. I wanted to make sure that we got a true and realistic budget proposal. So we began working around in April to discuss what our needs are, to identify our direction, our goals, what we wanted to achieve, what we wanted to accomplish, and what we needed to do to get there.
All right. Now, within this budget book, did you describe or explain your most critical need?
Yes, sir.
Did you do that at all public hearings regarding the 2018 budget that the Board of Commissioners held?
I believe there was one hearing that we did not present. I think Commissioner Chair Thurmond, I believe Commissioner Gaines was not present. We didn't present at that particular budget meeting.
But at any time you discussed your budget, did you explain your most critical need for 2018 budget?
That is correct.
All right. And what is that most critical need?
The most critical need is staffing.
And within your budget book, here on page 3 of that book, now we've lost the trying to think of what to do to get the system back up.
Yes, sir.
All right. So walk the judge through this page of your budget book. You have a separate book there if you need to refer to it. I'll put up here however you want me to do it.
Your Honor, if we begin by requesting what we were to unfreeze several positions. These positions were froze several years ago when the economy was in bad shape. We asked to unfreeze the, and these were the titles of the positions at the time. We'd asked to unfreeze one K-9 sergeant position, one accreditation manager position, four detention positions, one communications officer, one sheriff service deputy, one SRO position. And we also requested, due to the increase in caseloads, one new criminal investigator position assigned. After that, we did put down, or what I put in there in our budget book was our current staffing levels to let the commissioners know where we're at with our current staffing, which was 112 positions at the time. We did ask for a minimum. Our goal was hoping that the Board of Commissioners would work with us toward increasing our staff from our needs. So based upon a 2015 study that the Georgia Sheriff's Association conducted, they claimed that we were 37 positions, I believe, short at the time. Your Honor, we believe in taking what we have and using it to to its maximum capability. And what I wanted to do was implement a plan, or let's get these positions unfrozen. We know we're behind right now. Let's get these positions unfrozen, and then we can take time and evaluate and see what else our needs are. So we asked for those positions to be added, the frozen positions as well as the new position. And there, I put in there, if it was an approved position, that would increase our staffing to 122 positions, rather than the 139 that was requested by the Georgia Sheriff's Association.
And let's go through these positions. First of all, what would the accreditation manager, that was a title back in 2000, when the position was frozen, whenever that was?
That is correct.
And what was your intent with that position?
That would be reassigned to a uniformed role, an enforcement role.
And would any of these other positions also assist with patrol?
Absolutely. The K-9 sergeant would, the sheriff's service deputy would, which would increase our warrant service, our papers, the SRO position. Criminal investigator would be just for that, to assist with the increase of caseload.
Let me ask, on the issue, were those positions that were they prior approved, prior requested, but not approved or funded, or what?
Prior approved and no longer being funded.
Okay, were they ever in effect as far as being paid for?
I believe that.
Yes, sir, that is correct.
Okay, so those are active positions with people in them, and people being paid and funded that were basically terminated or something?
Reassigned, or if an employee left, they would not refill that position.
Okay. All right, go ahead, please.
So to follow up on the judge's question, when it's listed as unfrozen, those were positions that were funded at one time?
That is correct.
But they still had a position, they just were no longer funded?
Correct.
Do you know, Sheriff, approximately or when those positions were frozen as described here or no longer funded?
And this would just be a rough estimate. I would imagine probably 5-6 years ago on the accreditation manager, four positions probably in 2008, and that's an approximate. And I'm not sure on the others.
Okay, sure. All right. Now, you've referenced over here on this column recommended GSA staffing levels from a 2015 study, correct?
That's correct.
And within your budget book, have you included a tab that is that study?
That is correct.
And it's the final tab. Included within your budget book. Again, I'll back out, come back in. But that's the staffing analysis to which you refer.
That is correct.
And who prepared that staffing analysis?
That was completed by Bill Hallsworth, who is employed with the Georgia Sheriff's Association.
All right. Well, I need this more. Now, included within your budget book at tab one, your capital request, is that correct?
That is correct.
And Sheriff, I know you've done this and run the math, so I'm just going to ask it this way. Was the total amount of capital requests set forth within that tab $802,299?
That sounds correct.
And included within that was this CAD system that you previously described to the court?
That's correct.
And this at least was part of the estimate, was $521,487.
That looks great.
And there were some other maintenance costs associated with that.
That is correct.
Now, Sheriff, in connection with capital projects that are referenced here in your budget book in general, are you familiar with methods to fund the capital item?
Well, either through budget or through financing.
Through financing, all right. And are you aware of whether there's more options to fund a capital item than salaries and benefits for your employees?
Yes, there are some grant funds, things of that nature.
And SPLOST funds?
For, did you say for employees?
SPLOST funds for capital projects, are those?
Oh, that is correct.
Did you have any of those discussions with the commissioners? Did they ever ask you about funding these capital project items?
Not specifically about funding on those, sir.
Now, again, Sheriff, you've gone through the totals that are set forth in this budget book, is that correct?
That's correct.
And was the total budget request set forth in this book $9,930,498?
My numbers reflect $9,128,199.
Okay. And your number, does that include the capital project items?
No, sir.
Okay. So, but if we include those, that then gets you to the $9,934,98.
That sounds correct, yes, sir.
Did your numbers in this budget book include $600,000 of SPLOST proceeds?
No, sir.
But it included capital projects, correct?
Request, correct.
All right. And it included, your budget book included E-911.
Correct.
All right. Now, as we've previously gone through, the county's approved budget, the county asserted was $9,173,080. That included the SPLOST, is that correct?
Well, I don't have the total right here in front of me, Mr. Holmes.
All right. The record will reflect what your testimony was, but if that number, $9,173,080, includes SPLOST, and if the SPLOST is subtracted out, then the amount subject to your discretion was $8,573,080.
Approximate, yes, sir.
So they made cuts.
Yes, sir.
Now the commission, as we've previously gone through, approved some of your capital project requests, or at least budgeted for those, the 260 and the 40, right?
That's correct.
And that total was $300,000.
Yes, sir.
So if we back out that there was no funding or no arrangements made for what's in your budget book of $502,299, that was a cut on your cap. The balance of the cuts that were made to what your requested budget was and what was approved was approximately $850,000. Is that correct?
I believe that's correct, yes, sir.
If you'll just check the numbers there.
I'll make that a month, Mr. Holmes.
All right.
coming up with, Mr. Homans, minus the capital improvements, minus the splosh. This is just taking into account each component of the sheriff's office. That's reflect close to $800,000.
All right, $800,000. All right. Now, tell the judge how the cut of $800,000 affects your ability to perform your duties as sheriff to enforce the law and preserve the peace.
Well, what we've noticed, and especially since this study was done in 2015, which reflected that we were grossly inadequate in staffing, we've seen an increase, Your Honor, in crime, in our, especially in our retail district, in our shopping areas, things of that nature, a lot of fraud. We've had an increase in a lot of criminal investigations. When we look, or when I broke down the numbers, basically we did receive increases in 18, but the increases were dedicated to salaries and benefits, things of that nature. With the exception of a partially funded SRO, we received no staffing increase. Line items, when we talk about line items, this is our equipment, things of that nature that we need. We experienced a negative, we experienced a reduction over our 2017 budget, which I would contend was inadequate. We did have some relief at the end of 2017 with some money that was left able to purchase some things. But ultimately, we did see an overall increase in our budget due to the salary increases and associated benefits. We seen a decrease in our line items. We seen the only staffing we got was a partially funded SRO position.
Right. Tell the judge what you mean when you say a decrease in your line items.
Line items would vary from property repairs and maintenance, radio system equipment, uniforms, small equipment, just a whole list of things, Your Honor, that would build up or would make up the line items.
Go ahead. How would the budget cut impact the various divisions within the Sheriff's Department to perform the duties of preserving the peace and enforcing the law?
Absolutely. We were able to get some equipment at the end of 17. Once the budget was amended in 17, where we had some, or in April, where we got some additional funds for a salary. After the election, there was internal candidates, and there was lines drawn ultimately with a lot of the employees there. So in 16, after the election, we lost several employees. We've now built back up the staff that we are allotting. Going into looking forecast and what we have compared to 18, and it's our goal is to keep this thing staffed as well as we can. Right now we're competing with Forsyth, we're competing with Hall, we're competing with Gainesville because they've recently got pay raises, things of that nature. But it's our goal and it's our hope and prayer that we keep our staffing up. If so, if we're able to achieve that, we're well underfunded in our overtime budget, we're well underfunded in our line items. This year we were fortunate and had some extra money to do some things with, but our overtime costs were skyrocketed. We're basically wearing our people out. We do not have a relief factor. We do not have the ability to cover without calling in on overtime, without having mandatory days assigned that you've got to be by the phone. You got to be able to respond. One thing that we encountered in 16, after the election, Mr. Holmes, you stop me. We had some issues with payout of leave and things of that nature, just due to not being able to let the officers off. They wanted to take their time, they wanted to take vacations, but these dedicated men and women ultimately were told that, you know, public safety is number one, this is your job, this is your career, we need you here. So at the end of 16, there was a lot of money that was, the county policy says that if you do anything over 84 hours, you lose if you don't use it. And unfortunately, our men and women, that's an issue that we're having, one reason that we're here today as well.
All right. Is your policy on forfeited leave, your policy as sheriff, is that different than what the county's policy is as to forfeited leave?
It is.
All right, and what is your policy?
I believe it's fair. I believe it's earned leave is what it is. And that's the problem that we're running into. We had funds left in 16 budget. We had funds left in 17 to be able to pay these men and women for their earned leave. However, going into 18, we just don't even forecast that we're going to have the money there to be able to, with our staff, and we do not see any relief as it currently stands from our overtime issues, from our things that are affecting all of our components.
And as to your leave policy, or paying for forfeited leave, is your policy as sheriff different than what you understand the Board of Commissioners' policy is?
It is.
Are you willing to pay as sheriff for forfeited leave?
Absolutely.
And have you so informed the county offices that if you direct that that leave is not forfeited and should be paid?
We have.
And has it been paid?
Not yet.
So have you had to take it out of other budget funds that you would have to pay?
Hopefully that'll be the course.
So you've mentioned the overtime and the leave issues. How else does this budget cut of $800,000 affect your ability to perform your duties as sheriff?
Taking back, and what I'd like the public to understand and know is that the sheriff's office is comprised of a lot of components. You have your detention component, you have your patrol component, your investigation component. We currently have the 911 component, and we have the sheriff services component. Using the jail for an example, the jail is understaffed. Yes, we have been averaging about 100 inmates. Things that I expect to be testified to due to classification, due to mental issues, due to keep aparts. And when I say keep aparts, defendants maybe that are brought in together that we cannot house together for either violent reasons or investigative reasons. We have a medical wing that we're unable to fully staff. We're having to observe under camera different things. Our staff is severely inadequate in the jail. The jail is a primary feeder component for the rest of the office, Your Honor. It's your jail feeds, it's our goal, and it's commonplace in practice of other agencies that I've served in, is your jail, they come in, it's make or break. So these young men and women come in, they begin their career in law enforcement. That's where they decide or they earn the ability to go to the academy. And so last year in 17 alone, we were only able to send one person to the academy, which ultimately translates to a less safe community if we do not have proper staffing to keep our jail safe. It's also a severe restriction on our officer safety, just due to not having the ability to have backup clothes, things of that nature. So going into the academy right now, we're unable to send bodies on a regular basis to the academy and have these men and women certified and prepared to assume roles in the patrol position in case it comes up. So ultimately, my short staffing in the jail affects my patrol operations. Because I don't have the certified bodies ready to insert in these roles when these men and women, and if these men and women leave to go to surrounding agencies, which they have for higher pay. It all boils down to if we do not have the adequate staffing in our patrol to have these men and women out being proactive, being seen, being able to have the ability to actually patrol instead of, as Mr. Holman said earlier, as just call takers. We have to, I've always said that an ambulance riding down the road is not going to keep me from having a heart attack, but a patrol car sitting on the side of the street may prevent a crime, it may prevent a burglary, it may prevent a robbery. And right now, we're just not able to be proactive. So that results ultimately affects our criminal investigations. Our criminal investigations or investigator staffing wise are down, but yet our cases continue to crime, and it all relates to not having a strong presence on patrol, Your Honor. Drug investigations, our child molestations are up, our sex crimes are up, some of these frauds, these are very time consuming investigations. When you have to pull an officer out to attend a SANE exam or to attend a forensic exam and interview, and not even discussing the court time it takes for these officers and investigators to come in, these are times taken away from cases. And it ultimately translates to less service to our community. Our community is suffering. They need more of a police presence. We seen a gross increase in retail crimes associated in that other area. I believe in equal and fair representation. I believe that our folks on the north and on the west deserve adequate protection. And right now, we're having to take these bodies, these men and women on patrol, and we're having to respond to calls. We can't just ignore crimes over in our business area, in our retail area, which is leaving ultimately places of our county exposed and unprotected. And to me, it's just, it's unacceptable. And these are types of discussions that unfortunately we didn't get to have during the budget process, other than when we presented to the board. Sheriff Services is another prime example. We do not have the ability, with the increase of courts, with the increase of a new Superior Court judge this year, court cases will go up, and court security plans dictate minimum staffing for officers. We do not have the ability to fully staff our front screening station with two officers at all times. That's a problem. And that problem that our county, I want our county to know and understand, is that this is about protecting our county and protecting our people.
And in court services, you have also have the warrant division. Is that
That's
correct?
Correct.
Does this budget cut impact your ability to timely serve criminal arrest warrants?
Absolutely. And I believe our court commander may testify that he's constantly having to pull folks, transports, that he has to lean on already understaffed jail sometimes to be able to go find a certified body, which is normally a supervisor or a commander, to go transport. We're unable to have teams out serving warrants to lock these men and women up that have committed crimes and have pending warrants on them.
Now, you based your staffing request on the 2015 study, is that correct?
That's correct.
And has the county grown since 2015?
Yes, sir.
First of all, was that taken into account in your budget request, the growth? Or are you just seeking to get the 2015 level?
Well, that's not even the 2015 level, Mr. Holmes. That's just trying to enter into this thing that was hopeful that we would work with the board to be able to start working toward those numbers.
And tell the judge the growth of which you're familiar with Dawson County from 2015, or whatever the effective date of the study is, to 2018.
We've had several things, and a lot of the information that I'll present came directly from the Dawson County Planning and Commission, as well as the finance reports that are submitted monthly to the Board of Commissioners. We've seen an increase in commercial as opposed to residential. This is where a lot of our problems are happening over in the commercial district. They were 25% higher than residential demands in 16, and they jumped to 52% higher residential in 17. So again, this translates to our officers are having to be over to answer these crimes, to work these crimes that's leaving areas of our county unattended.
And when you gave that percentage, was that the permits or was that number of calls?
Well, this just deals, Mr. Holman's, just with the commercial and residential numbers that we're looking at, commercial versus residential crime. And again, obtaining information from planning and zoning, it looks like from 15 through 17, there were approximately 432 new businesses open. During that same time, businesses closed, but they're still resorting in the numbers that I've got are approximately 188 new businesses that have come on since 2015. Our calls for service have increased. Our motor vehicle accidents increased. All these things associated with the retail area, our in and autos have increased, which obviously we're bringing more people to the county. We've seen an increase, Your Honor, on missing persons. These are time consuming. These are labor intensive when we have to devote the personnel and the resource to do that. You know, for who knows unknown reasons, child abuse investigations, molestations have just absolutely doubled since 15. These are, again, time-consuming investigations that we must account for. We've seen an increase since lost dollars. We've seen an increase in lost collections. These, to me, tell us as well and reinforce the idea that more people are coming to Dawson County to spend money and do business, which also increases crime. Our numbers residential have been the permits, and again, I don't know exactly how to define this, but total building permits issued, the numbers I received were 1,425 since 15. So we're adding, there's residential areas being developed as we speak with increased housing and multi-housing and things of that nature. We're behind.
Now, since 2015, the Kroger Shopping Center and the Public Shopping Center on each side of 400 have been built and are now operational, is that correct?
That is correct.
And just so it's in the record, can you generally describe those two shopping centers for the court, please?
Well, they're big developments, and they continue to build them, Your Honor. I couldn't get an estimate on the number of stores in there, but this is just not a standalone grocery store. These are big developments.
Now, as a result of that, what you just testified to, are your supervisors in each of these divisions able to serve a supervisory role?
No, sir.
Tell the judge what you mean by that.
Our supervisors in Dawson County, and as far as long as I've been here, Your Honor, perform a function of a line officer. And what I mean by that, Dawson County has five zones. Supervisor, it's not uncommon at all for a supervisor to have to take a zone. So it takes away from their ability to supervise. And what I mean by that is being proactive, checking on your officers, being able to back them up, things of that nature. Now, or ever since I've been here, the supervisors have to maintain a role of basically they're wearing rank, but they're performing the duties of a line level officer, which to me is another disservice to the county. We have to have our supervisors able. It's an officer safety issue. We have to have them available to respond to back up. We have to have them available to be able to lend guidance, to teach, instruct, mentor. We just don't have that here, Governor.
And so what do the supervisors have to do then if somebody else that they supervise needs their assistance?
Well, if they're tied up on a call, the officer's on their own.
Now, does it also impact the ability for training for your officers?
Absolutely.
Tell the judge how.
Your Honor, we're required by post to obtain X amount of hours a year. We do try to do a lot of that in-house, but a lot of your more detailed training, a lot of your specialty training is off-site. And a lot of the classes, I would say majority of the classes are 40-hour classes. And with the staffing levels we have, we just can't afford to send our officers off to train. Which in turn is a disservice to our community. I truly believe that a knowledgeable officer, an experienced officer, a well-trained officer better serves our community.
Does it put your officers at risk by not having that training?
Absolutely.
Put the public at risk?
Absolutely.
And what is the reason you can't send them to training?
We just don't have the staffing. We don't have the relief factor.
Does the cut or lack of staffing affect your ability to have meetings with you as officers? Or as they change shifts?
Absolutely.
Tell the judge about that.
Your Honor, it really astounded me when I first came to Dawson County in 2004 that we didn't have shift change. And basically what shift change is, for everyone's knowledge, is an officer basically, now they may get on the radio, now don't get me wrong, we've got some dedicated officers that are still coming to work early, but I can't get the funding, I can't force them to come in early for shift change. I just don't have the funding, and that was denied during our budget request. And basically, a shift change is where the officers come in early, the supervisors come in a little bit earlier, they meet with each other, they discuss any special issues that's went on during the days, they discuss any special bolos, they exchange information, anything that needs done at night, anything on day shift that they may need to follow up with, that gives them the opportunity to meet and speak with it. The officers normally would come in 15 minutes early, they would stand in formation, the supervisor would inspect them, make sure that they have the equipment, the gear, make sure that they're physically able and that they're not under any type of, and Lord help, I hope that doesn't happen, but not under any type of intoxicant things of that nature. The supervisor needs to see, needs to have the ability to speak with them, needs to have the ability to inspect them before these men and women go on duty. The supervisor passes along information, BOLOs, gives district assignments, zone assignments, things of this nature. And it's critical that we have it, and I don't know of any other county around that still operates as we do.
What about over in jail?
The same thing, Your Honor. Mr. Homans, it's there's no shift change there.
In your funding, do you have sufficient funding for administrative staff or administrative personnel?
We have taken, Your Honor, over the years, when and this was primarily done to increase our law enforcement presence. We've taken administrative assistance. When criminal investigations, when this building was opened, we didn't have a staff. We moved from a shack into a mansion when we left our courthouse, which increased our staffing. And we had to take the information that I've got from a captain who was in investigations at the time, is that they took one administrative assistant that was in criminal investigations, and a lieutenant when he retired, or an investigator when he retired, they transferred those two positions to staff the courthouse as we have it now. Criminal investigations has no administrative assistant to help them to do the administrative work. It falls back on the shoulders of the investigators. The patrol component has no administrative assistant. They did it one time. We've reduced our administrative staff and reassigned them to uniform roles in an effort to try to reduce crime in our community and try to increase public safety. But we borrowed and borrowed and borrowed, and now we're down to bare bones where we just don't have anybody else to borrow from.
And what impact does lack of administrative personnel have on the ability to protect the public and enforce the law?
Well, the administrative staff is critical to allow our supervisors and allow our command staff to actually do their jobs. And right now, a lot of those administrative duties are falling back on the component commanders. And I admire them for what they're doing, but we continually boils down to public safety. Our goal is public safety and increase in safety. And when these commanders have to do these administrative tasks, it takes them out of their role of what they need to be doing.
Now, you've described to the judge the new process you went through with your 2018 budget, from the budget book to the public hearings, correct?
That's correct.
Did county personnel meet with you before you made the budget presentation on July 5, 2017, as you described?
That is correct. Again, internally with the command staff, we began meeting in April to discuss it. Around June 1st, Sandra Evans, our budget manager, and I met with Vicki Newkirk and Natalie Johnson. And please forgive me if I missed said the name wrong, but with finance to discuss what our needs were.
Okay. And did you have your budget book at that time? Did you over it with them?
I don't know if we had a budget book, but we had our numbers, we had our justifications.
Right. And at that meeting, were you given recommended numbers?
No, sir. Right.
When did you get what the recommended numbers were from county staff, finance department?
We met June the 1st with Ms. Vicki and Ms. Natalie, and we began to, through Ms. Evans, we began to ask for the recommended numbers. We were getting a little concerned with it because each time that we would inquire, well, they're not ready yet, or we don't have them. We actually received our recommended numbers from finance the morning we presented to the board our budget.
And have you had a chance to review what staff recommended now?
Yes, sir.
All right. And how close was that to what the Board of Commissioners ultimately approved?
It was what, the recommended numbers to what they approved?
Yes.
It was very close. They made a few adjustments. We did also meet, met briefly with the chairman, met briefly with two of the commissioners as well to discuss budget. However, there was no specific discussions about how we can increase public safety, what we can do to make our community safer. When I originally met with the commission chair, basically it was a conversation of we only have so much money to go around, but there's no discussion whatsoever about budget, about staffing, about line items, things of that nature. when the major and I met with Commissioners Gaines and Nix, we did have a brief discussion on capital improvements. Basically, what's your priority with them? We had no discussion on staffing. We had no discussion on line items. We did have a lot of discussion on county attorney. We did have a discussion on finance issues, things of that nature.
All right. And in connection with those finance issues, had you encountered disagreements with the county or county personnel about personnel matters or purchases?
Yes, we have.
All right, describe that to the court, please.
Your Honor, we went, we had some issues. Well, right off the bat, we had issues with the payback of the leave for the officers. And basically, it was that's outside of county policy. We can't do that.
That's overtime that hasn't been paid, that has taken its time off.
Well, not overtime, Your Honor. It's time that they, you know, they earn like 10 hours a month for leave time.
Okay.
And it builds through the year.
Okay.
We also had some concerns about the heating and air vendor that we've had. Fortunately, I've been employed with the Sheriff's Office for 2004, and as the jail commander for some time, I handled quite a bit of the maintenance for the Sheriff's Office. Had a lot of bad experiences with one of the vendors, not contacting our county maintenance folks when they were coming in, things that were said were being done, not being done. So I opted to go with an outside vendor for the for our heat and air supply, which we have greatly reduced in 17 what we spent on maintenance with it. I think we had some concerns with maintenance on our generator. We have a approximately $750,000 generator that operates our jail, that operates our 911 center, things like that. We have a lot of people coming in, the county contractors that are changing all the different things, and we were having a lot of issues with it. So we opted to go back to the CAT, the person or the vendor that made it, and we have virtually eliminated our issues with it. But it was a public safety issue. It was a 911 issue that we needed good service on our and regular service on our generators. Purchasing, we've had some issues, things of that nature.
And did you schedule and have meetings with county personnel regarding what I'll call these ongoing issues?
We did. You and I met with Chairman Thurmond and Dave Headley, the county manager.
And was any form or proposed solution ever submitted back to you from anybody at the county to resolve those ongoing issues?
Not a form or anything like that.
And so as we sit here today, did the deputies that had forfeited leave that you agreed to pay, have they been paid?
Not yet.
That's all I have at this time, Your Honor.
Ross?
Good morning, Sheriff.
Hey, Mr. Frye.
I'll try not to go back over everything about the deputies. The $350,000 that was set aside for the 2017 budget that you've discussed with Mr. Homans, that amount was set aside when the budget for 17 was done in November of 2016, right?
That sounds correct.
And that amount was set aside for implementation of a salary study that had been done and was being redone on an ongoing basis going into 17, right?
That's correct.
And that $350,000, just to be clear, was for implementation across the board, not simply for any one department or office.
Right, spread out.
That was your understanding?
Right. Right.
So you didn't know what, if any, amount would go to the sheriff's office?
No, sir.
Let me ask, with respect to budget and the numbers, is this numbers for various kind of items, including staffing positions and all that, and then there's a total for the budget. Is there any, you contend, is any obligation that the sheriff comply with spending those line items precisely as they're in the budget? Or is it simply a matter that those numbers and line items are a basis for reaching an overall number to say, okay, this is the total money that's allocated to the sheriff for this year, but there's nothing to stop him from changing where the money's spent and for what?
In general, it's very much the latter. Because of the budgeting process, it's necessary to put these funds into categories and line items for the largest part of those monies. It is possible, particularly for the general fund monies, for the sheriff to make a determination that he wants to move monies around.
Okay, so you could say,
spend them in a
different way. I got three officers quit. I'm not replacing. I'm buying some cars and that kind of stuff.
He could do that, or vice versa. Rather than equipment, he could add officers.
Okay.
He could move officers, deputies from one area to another as he sees fit.
Except the splosh and that kind of thing, which
absolutely
is non-discretionary.
And as we said, there are some other things that are restricted.
Yeah.
The primary thing, though, is the splosh money, because that is restricted. Even the Board of Commissioners can't do a whole lot to change that. It's largely dictated by the resolution, the ballot, and the intergovernmental agreement.
I understand. Go ahead, please.
Okay, sorry. How much did your salaries in this 2018 budget as compared with the 2017 final approved and amended, because there were amendments to implement the salary study, how much did the salaries for your sheriff's office overall go up from 2017 to 2018?
Can I step aside and get a?
Sure.
I've got this figured out, Mr. Wright.
Please.
Tell us where it is, but I haven't touched paper.
That's all right. I'm sure.
Mr. Fryer, when I computed my figures, I didn't include initially any splosh items, any capital improvements. These figures are based just on each component, salaries, and line items.
Okay. Salaries, does that include benefits and associated
yes,
costs?
It does. Okay. From the difference between the adjusted 17, what I mean by the adjusted 17, is after the salary increase. So the difference between salary increase 17 and the approved and recommended 18 total $275,585, according to my figures.
Okay. And for 17, that the figure as far as the salary study additional funds that were implemented, that would have been for roughly 18 pay period rather than the full 26, given that it didn't happen until what, April?
Should have been, right.
In 2018, it's for the full 26 pay period.
Yes, sir.
And that's what you're comparing?
Well, yes, sir, I compared all of it, right.
And what document are you referring to?
This is one that I've made, Mr. Fry, and basically I've broken it down into what our 2017 budget originally was, what our 17 after the amendment was, what we requested, what was recommended, the differences between the different ones.
Is that document in evidence?
I don't believe it is. I believe it's one.
Mr. Approach?
Yes, sir. I'll be next.
This document was prepared by you or under your directions?
By me.
And to the best of your knowledge, it's
yes, accurate. Sir. Yes, sir.
Your Honor, I'd like to have this marked as a respondent's exhibit, like a copy of it. I'm fine with him keeping the original.
All right, what number is it?
This would be, I believe it would be R24.
And what is? And what is it?
I'll ask him to give a description of this document that we can move forward to.
Your Honor, basically what this document was, I broke it down into each component that falls under the sheriff's office. And what I mean by that is there's not one big lump budget number. We have, at the end, there's a lump number. But we have like admin, patrol, investigations that's lumped together with the budget. K-9's, we've got a separate budget. The jail's got a separate budget. Sheriff Services has a separate budget, 911. So basically, we broke it down, and, or I broke it down into each component, what was budgeted in 2017. The change after April 8th with the salary increases, what it went up to. There's a line item there or a column for requested 18. That's what we requested as part of our budget, what the county recommended. And then I broke down the differences between the wards.
And this is, trying to think of a name or a title to put this in the evidence by an identification. It would be Sheriff's
Comparisons.
What you call
Comparisons,
it?
Comparisons, or?
Sheriff's Summary of Comparisons. Various versions of 2017 and 18
great
budgets.
Yes.
Council, can you put a number on that? Yes.
And we will refer to this as R24.
Okay. Any objection?
No, no.
It's admitted.
Thank you.
Yes.
You might want to hang on with that. I have some other
yes.
things that might relate to it, but those references would help. You mentioned that when you joined the Dawson County Sheriff's Office, you were surprised that they were not doing a shift change consultation. I've heard that referred to in other areas and departments as pass down.
Correct.
Sort of thing.
That is.
They weren't doing that.
No, sir.
When did it start?
It hasn't.
It has not started yet.
We included that in our budget. We took a calculation and estimate of what it would cost to be able to budget for that, which was not budgeted for or recommended.
Okay. And did you budget it as a separate item or simply justify it as a separate number because you're increasing a given number?
We increased, yes, sir, our salary request, and that's where we increased, that's where we inserted those numbers. We didn't have a separate line item for shift change or pass down.
That's what I wanted to make clear is that in your request, it was not broken out separately.
That's correct.
You just referred to that as your estimate of what it would require in the way of an increase.
That's correct.
So your salary figure for 2018 is increased over your 2017 numbers, even if you consider it the final 2017, the amended numbers, 2018 is still bigger.
That's correct. The differences that I calculated, and I'm not a numbers person, but I went through these things as much as I could. The difference between the adjusted 17 and the approved 18 was $275,585. Now, out of that $275,585, $272,000 of it, $367,000, is directly attributable to salaries and associated benefits. Which means there was $3,000 left in line item increases. However, we received part of that 28, there was 28,000 or 29,000 that was transferred from fire to 911 to help pay for radio maintenance. So basically, we resulted in a deficit of $24,000, nearly 25,000 for line items. So overall, we did see an increase, but the increase was dedicated to the salaries and to the associated benefits. And Mr. Frey, on your previous question, in the budget book, which was completed by Ms. Evans at my direction, she did include in the salaries, it talks about shift change, 15-minute supplement for all shift personnel, 30-minute for sergeants and above, as well as, and I did request a 2% increase for our personnel. So those numbers were factored into my budget request for salaries and benefits.
Okay, the 2% that you were requesting was for an increase that would occur at the beginning of 2018?
That's what I was requesting, yes.
Okay, and that would be in addition to the increases that had been granted pursuant to the countywide salary study in April of 2017?
That's what I would like to have.
Just curious, when Mr. Homans was asking you about the peer jurisdictions that were considered in the salary study, I think it's P9 is his exhibit, a number of counties
yes,
in this area, three municipalities were considered. Did you for any reason disagree with the use of those as references?
I don't think, and this is just my personal opinion, Mr. Fry, but we lose officers south of us. Forsyth County is roughly paying 40 to 41,000. Estimating the Star, Hall County's just increased theirs to 40, or estimated thereabout. Gainesville's increasing theirs. And that's what makes it tough for Dawson County is that we have dedicated men and women here that want to serve in Dawson County, but they have a service heart, passion to serve. However, when marriage and kids and life comes along, it's hard to argue with $5,000-$6,000 a year increase with it. So those tend to be our competitors. But you know, some of the mountain counties that were included in there, we're just not seeing officers go to those areas. Relatively, you know, for whatever reasons.
You've been saying that for a good while now. In fact, you were saying that very thing in your campaign forum appearances back in the campaign lead up to your election. Is that correct?
That's right.
Do you recall saying in those same campaign forums that, to use your words, that crime had been drastically reduced leading up to the time of your comments in those campaign forums?
I don't recall that.
You don't recall?
No, sir.
Do you deny it, that you said that?
You're saying that I made the statement that crime had been drastically reduced?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Fry, I based my statements on solid numbers, and I don't recall. That doesn't ring a bell, nor does it sound something that'd be indicative of what I would say, unless I had hard concrete facts back it up.
If you said it, you were wrong.
If I said it, I was wrong. Right. Key word ill. And Mr. Fry, when I was running for sheriff, I did not have control over patrol. I had no control over investigations. I was a jail commander at the time, so to even say that I drastically reduced crime, I...
Not that you had drastically reduced crime. What you had said in the forums was that the crime in Dawson County had been drastically reduced.
You'd have to say that to me, Mr. Fry.
Let me ask you, you mentioned several different categories of what I'd call benchmarks in terms of those kind of things a little earlier. Let's see if I can find those. How did calls for service that you referenced run, what was the total for the year for 2015?
These numbers as well were taken from our 911 director, and she pulled these numbers directly from our system. So being, according to the study behind in 15, we've seen all of our activity in 15 at 61,241. Activity dropped in 16 to 54,000, but in 17, 54,679, in 17, we jumped to 65,963.
Let me ask you, what do those numbers represent? They're not service calls per se. Those are dispatch communications?
Well, and Ms. Lisa could explain it more. This is officer initiated. This is 911 initiated. This is all activity from my understanding of it.
How many did you have for 2015, did you say?
All activity showed 61,241.
And then what is the comparable figure for 2016?
16, it went to 54,679.
And for 17?
65,963.
So it varies?
Yes, sir.
How many motor vehicle accidents occurred, according to your records, in 2015 in Dawson County?
According to the numbers that Ms. Alicia pulled, in 15, there was 1,226.
And in 16?
1,285.
And in 17?
1,352.
And how many motor vehicle related fatalities were there in 2015?
According to this, 10.
And 16?
2.
2 and 17?
7.
7. So it varies as well?
Yes, sir.
You referred to some specific benchmarks, as I recall there. How about arrests? How did those vary from 2015 to 2017 by the sheriff's office?
I don't know that I have those numbers, Mr. Wright. I don't have those numbers available.
You don't have them available at all?
Well, we can get them, I just don't have them with me.
Would you have any reason to think that the numbers that y'all have reported, the sheriff's office has reported to the county, are not accurate?
No, those would be accurate. Those are taken from our jail computer. If you're asking about, I'm not sure what stats you get. Is it jail population or is it?
I was going to get to that, but that actually was not the one I was referring to. But I'll move to something else. At this point, let me ask you about the inmates. You have figures for monthly high, monthly low, and monthly average census at the jail.
That's correct.
For every month going back how far?
I don't know when that started. The county started requesting that some time back, but it's been, even when I was the jail commander, we were providing those numbers.
Okay, so it goes back at least to 2015?
Yes, sir. I'm sure of it.
Do you have those numbers here somewhere?
I do not have those numbers with me, but again, they're easily accessible.
Okay. Do you have inmate census numbers in any form
with me?
Yes.
No, sir.
But again, the numbers that you and your staff provide each month to the county would be the best numbers you have.
That's okay. Taken directly from our jail computer.
Would it be fair to say, based on your familiarity with that subject as the former head jailer and head detention officer in charge of the jail and now in charge of everything over there, that the average inmate census for 2017 on a monthly basis would have been essentially lower for every single month of 2017 as compared to the same month of 2016?
I would have to say the statistics.
Okay.
And you wouldn't disagree with that, would you?
Well, I can't agree with it without seeing it.
Overall, you do know that the average daily census for 2017 is lower than it was in 2016.
I would expect that.
And by how many?
I can tell you without looking at the numbers. I wouldn't even want to take a guess.
Why is it lower?
Well, there's been a lot of changes to it. And one is that when we talk about staffing, when we talk about enforcement, we're call takers now. And basically, when you're running, taking reports and calls and things of that nature, you can't be as proactive. Our investigators are bogged down working cases and so forth. And so they're not able to get out and be proactive to help keep our community safe. There's been changes in, you know, there's been reform changes where the state used to be, if an inmate was sentenced to state, it was not uncommon for us to sit home for 6 months. We would get a check from them. Now, if an inmate's sentenced to state, they're gone.
They move out quicker.
Right. So there's a lot of things that may contribute to the lower population.
At one point, was the Dawson County Jail accepting inmates from other detention facilities that were, for whatever reason, not able to handle them at the other facilities?
We have, yes.
When did that stop?
When I took over as jail commander in 2007, they had already been gone. And I can't remember if it was Hall, I think it was Forsyth County inmates, Hall underbid, or Lumpkin County underbid this, and they moved them out and moved them to Lumpkin County. But that's not an issue now. Most jails have bed space available. Most counties have new jails. But, you know, it's not an issue trying to find inmates to house nowadays. You know, that was some contracted things. Now, we've done favors for other counties as well as they've done for us. But that's just taking care of each other.
You say you were underbid in the sense of you charged maybe a less competitive rate for housing inmates from other counties.
That's correct.
What do you charge now when you house an inmate from another county?
Well, we don't. Again, we just don't have a need to.
You don't house inmates from other counties now, or you don't charge for it when you do?
We don't. Now, what I mean by that, I'm sorry.
You don't what?
We don't charge for them.
Right.
And I'll give you an example. Hall County asked us to house about 12 inmates for them when they was going through some restructure and things of that nature, and we did. But Hall County in the past has housed for us. We housed with them for it was at least a month. If my memory serves me correct, about 2 months.
When was that?
This was when we was doing jail refurbishing, and this was 2008, maybe 2009, when we went through inside. The jail obviously takes a beating with people in there, and they do their damage to it, but they house for us, didn't charge us anything. We try to take care of...
Not charge us anything?
Nothing. Right. We try to take care of each other, and right now, currently, we had a violent incident with one of our officers that was beaten. You may be familiar with that, and he needed 24-hour medical care. He needed more direct supervision, which our staffing didn't allow, so a neighboring county is graciously housed in for us at no charge. That's what we do for each other, take care of each other. In incidents of if we needed resources, if we needed SWAT teams, if we needed in law enforcement, you don't do that to your brothers and sisters. You take care of each other. You provide the resources to get the job done.
So you need more detention officers to operate your jail in the optimal manner is something you're telling us here today?
That's correct.
Does Hall County's detention center need more officers? Detention officers to operate theirs in an optimal manner?
I don't know, Mr. Fry. I don't know what their level is.
Have they told you that as a justification for sending prisoners over here for you to house this past year?
Right. We ran into some conflict in that. When it originally came over to us, they were doing some refurbishing, things like that. They had a few inmates that they needed to board with us. And then we read an article, something about staffing levels over there. So that prompted us to get clarification on what it was. And it seemed to be a combination of the both. But again, and when we talk about housing inmates, when we talk about sending other ones, it's when you house an inmate, when you charge to house an inmate, they're going to send you the absolute worst of the worst because you're paying the housing. Hall County done that years ago with Fulton County, when Sheriff Couch took office, he booted them out, he was having officers assaulted, he was having his facility destroyed, and the costs just weren't there to generate, there were so many issues and so many officer safety issues. So that's an issue that you have with it, but when we take care of each other, when we do things, just like this man that we have housed in a neighboring county right now, very violent tendencies, things like that, they have more adequate staff, they have a little bit more secure area, they have 24-hour medical coverage that they can take care of. Again, no cost to us. So that's the type of thing that we do for each other. It's rare, it's uncommon, it's not an everyday occurrence. So to answer your question, we do house occasionally, it's not. Ultimately, what it is, and I think what you may be around to, and I don't want to lead you, you know, if you stop me or not, but is that population numbers are down. However, it doesn't negate our requirements for classification, doesn't negate our to separate males and females, maximum and medium security and detailed inmates. And there's still, we can't just lump them in one room and put one person supervising them. It's just, you know, even our facility is built labor intensive the way it's designed. So that's the problem that we have. Our staffing, our inmate population is down, but we still have duties and requirements and mandates that's placed on us to watch, to provide medical. There's a lot of things that go into how we house and how we supervise.
Going back to a question that we managed to kind of bypass an answer to, and I'm not suggesting that's your fault, but I'd ask you, over the last few years, have the number of arrests changed in a way that you can tell us what the trend has been there?
Well, I don't have the number of arrests with me.
Are you not aware that the number of arrests has fallen by the hundreds?
I'm not aware of that.
2012 to 2017?
I'm not aware of that. Again, I just haven't seen the statistics. Again, a lot of that's contributed. We went through severe staffing, as we testified to earlier. Our officers have turned into responders instead of being proactive. You know, our investigations are down. They're bogged down with different things. They don't have the ability to get out and be proactive. There's a lot of reasons that may contribute to that.
But whatever else they're doing, they're not doing nearly as many arrests, isn't that fair to say?
Again, I'd have to see the numbers on it.
And you don't have those numbers?
Not with me, no, sir.
Are you aware of them being in any of the exhibits that your council has here for you?
I don't even think we've talked about arrest numbers.
How much population growth has occurred in Dawson County between 2015 and 2017?
Well, I don't have the numbers. I just have some statistics pulled from planning and zoning for building and things of that nature.
Right. You don't know, do you?
I don't have the numbers.
Do you have an estimate?
Well, if you figure two people per house, you know, and again, I don't want to base a decision on estimates. I do know that our planning and zoning permits are up. I do know that business licenses are up. I do know the cost for service are up. I do know that motor vehicle accidents are up. All contributes to tell me that we were behind in 2015, and we're even further behind in 2018.
And what you're referring to now, conveniently, is cost for service. You're referring to
editorializing during
all
the
right,
question.
I'll take that back. What you're now referring to as calls for service, you weren't able to substantiate as calls for service a little while ago. You said those were all activities through the 911 center that involved people. Is that right?
When you say calls for service, are you talking about actual 911 calls that come in?
That's what I was asking about, but you didn't answer that. You gave
well, if you've been clear with Mr. Price, I probably would have answered it.
Okay.
Non-officer initiated, which I believe is the cost for service. Miss Alicia can verify this for you.
Okay.
2015, it was 11,060. It dipped in 2016 to 10,931. It increased in 17 to 11,494.
Thank you.
Two or three people to a house, is that what you're saying, Mayor, then?
I'm guessing.
Okay, don't want you to guess.
Well, I don't have the numbers.
Let me ask it a different way, maybe you won't have to guess. Do you know how many of those residences that had been permitted or approved in some fashion have actually been built?
I don't have that number.
You have no idea, do you?
I can ride around and show you developments underway currently. Houses being built, apartments and complexes being built, but I don't have a number to put on.
Do you have numbers beyond, you said there were 188 new businesses between 2015 and 2018. Do you have numbers for the commercial businesses other than that 188? Is that the number that?
The reports I received from planning and zoning, and we looked at the numbers that had been created since 15. The businesses had closed during 15, and that was our net surplus.
Okay, and those were licenses?
That was numbers we got for businesses.
So you don't know exactly what that represents?
New businesses.
New businesses in some cities?
Yes.
Maybe a business that got a license and never opened for all you know.
Well, it still said open, it's not closed. And we made sure that when we went through there that we looked specifically for Dawson County businesses. A lot of people obtain a license that don't have a business here, but they do it to operate here. So those were Dawson County numbers.
You mentioned the new Kroger shopping center as a good example of the new business. There's the Kroger, and then there are other stores in there with it in the new shopping center. There was a Kroger and other stores with it in the old Kroger shopping center that closed. Is that not correct?
That's correct.
Right. The Kroger in that shopping center is moved. It's a bigger Kroger, but it's not a new business. It's just a relocated business.
That's right, Kroger, right.
And when Kroger left, is it not true that a number of those businesses also closed down in the old Kroger shopping center? Not just Kroger, there are a number of vacancies.
They would have been minimal. I know the AT&T store moved, but there's still businesses in the old Kroger shopping center, a couple of Kroger.
A lot of vacancies too, aren't there?
Yeah, they're minimal. New businesses came, and I've heard the statement given to me by the commissioner as well, we didn't get new businesses, they just moved, which was absolutely incorrect.
When it comes to paying your deputies and staff, you would agree, would you not, that you can reassign people to different duties, correct?
Correct.
You can reassign them to a different job title if you wanted to.
Correct.
You can change their rate of pay up or down if you felt it was appropriate.
If the funds are there.
Well, and that's a good point. Subject to the overall funds available in your budget, and I'm talking about funds that aren't restricted, such as the SPLOST numbers, essentially, the sheriff has the discretion and authority to decide how many people he wants, what he wants them to do, and the terms of their employment, including pay. Is that correct?
All within the confines of how much money we have.
Right. You can't do more than you have money for.
Correct.
But beyond that, you can arrange them and assign them as you deem appropriate.
That's correct.
When at the end of 2016, you had a number of folks who had worked and did not use the leave that they had accrued and then lost the leave according to county policy. As a sheriff, it took a while, but you informed the county that your decision as sheriff was to grant those people
that leave rather than have it lapse. Is that correct?
Absolutely.
But you still have not paid them for that. At the end of 2016, how much was left in the sheriff's overall budget, general fund budget, let me say that, that lapsed into the fund balance?
This is this. It seemed like it was $100,000 that it went back to the general fund.
How much was needed to pay for the lost leave time for those people that you had requested pay for?
I think, Mr. Pratt, about $40,000.
So over the course of this past year, 2017, notwithstanding all the discussions and notwithstanding your decision, you have not actually paid them for that.
That's correct.
At the end of 2017, you had told the commission that you anticipated you would have several hundred thousand dollars left over, and after being urged to go ahead and address some of your 2018 needs in 2017 so as to avoid another lapse of funds, you did so, is that correct?
I did purchase, yes.
Right.
And with the intent of that, it's, none of us won't be here, but it was the intent that we could work together, reserve the money, and come to an agreement where we could staff the positions that we needed to be. However, as the year progressed on, we realized we weren't getting anywhere, so we were trying to get the equipment and the items that we needed to do.
What things did you
do? I asked to be allowed to complete his answer.
Yeah, if you weren't finished, please go ahead.
I'm done.
Let me ask you, what items did you, or what things did you purchase with that money that you didn't have in the 2017 budget line items, but you felt you could go ahead and use that money and anticipate and take care of some of the 2018 items?
Well, and again, kind of go back to the other question, I will answer your question for that. You know, to me, a budget is, you base your budget, you're a good steward with that money, that you buy what you need, and at the end, you turn the rest in. And, but unfortunately, we're placed in a position in 17 where we felt like we was going to get something to avoid this here, however we didn't. And so at the end of the year, instead of just having that money lost, we purchased some firearms, we purchased vests, bulletproof vests, we purchased tasers, just things like that, equipment that was needed.
These are items that you would have otherwise hoped to have had funding in the 2018 budget as you have requested?
Absolutely.
So you've gone ahead and taken care of at least those needs?
Absolutely.
But you, in your discretion and authority as the sheriff, determined that it's more appropriate to do that than to pay the $40,000 that you say your folks have been waiting all year for?
The 40 is still available to them. And the reason we haven't paid the 40 is it's been wrapped up in this litigation.
In what sense is it still available to them?
Well, there's still excess of money that was returned in from 17 to 18.
How much excess from 17 is been put back into the general fund?
I don't have that number, but I know it's, there's still money available.
Is it enough if it had not been left at the end of 2017, go back into the general fund, was it enough that it would have paid that $40,000?
Sure.
So why didn't you go ahead and do it?
Again, this is part of the litigation that we've been involved with. And I believe Mr. Holmes and I have even sat and talked about that. I believe that even at one of the board of commissions that Mr. Holmes requested that they be paid, and that's never been done.
Well, you tell finance and personnel what your decisions are in terms of payment to your people, what they're entitled to as a salary, as benefits, that you tell that because you are the sheriff. You make those decisions. And you made the decision that they be paid that leave money. Is that right?
Yes.
Right. have you directed, as you directed so many other things to be paid, that that money be paid out of your available general fund money that was in your budget for 2017? Have you done that?
Again, it's been brought up. I haven't directly told them or instructed them to send the money. I know it's been brought up during the board meetings, and even Mr. Holmans has mentioned it. We still agree that residual funds left in from the 16 budget were sufficient to be able to pay them as well.
So because you disagree with the accounting for the end of the year in 2016, you've made a decision not to pay that $40,000 that you feel and have decided is due to your people, even though you had the money in 2017.
Mr. Fry, I don't know what to tell you other than it's been brought up. Did I send pen, did I put pen to paper and say, pay our officers this 40 something thousand? No, sir, I haven't. But it has been brought up and it's been part of this lawsuit.
It, as many times as you've been back and forth through your staff and the county staff and finance and HR, and the upshot of it all has been that you have the authority to make those decisions, and they need simply to have you direct them what you want to do. Is that correct?
Yes.
And you're willing to do that?
We can do that and get that part out of the way, yes.
Yeah, and you're, oh, let me ask you this, just to solve a simple ongoing thing. Is Ms. Evans authorized by you to move funds around within your general fund budget under your authorization?
At mine or the chief deputy's authorization.
Yours or Greg Rowan's?
That's correct.
Right. Is there anything that you would like the finance department to know in terms of whether you have to sign off on those things personally or not?
I do sign off on, well, myself or the chief deputy does sign off on all purchases.
All right. How about transfers from one line item to another within your existing budget?
Again, we discuss with our budget manager, Sandra Evans. She comes to us with budget moves before they're made.
All right. Does she have authority on her own to direct the county finance staff to make those changes, or does that correction have to come from you to finance?
She sends an email.
Okay. She sends an email.
Or calls.
All right, and when she does that, and say from this point forward, let's not try to reinvent the wheel here. From this point forward, and this will solve a lot of back and forth for us. Can she do it for you in your name without having anything from you in the way of an email or separate authorization for a particular transaction in a blanket way, so that if she says to finance, transfer money in whatever amount from whatever category or line item to another, finance is to accept Ms. Evans' direction in that regard?
I think we have addressed that with the your finance department, and that Ms. Evans has been making budget moves for years, long before I became chair. Why it became an issue recently, I'm not sure. I don't know where it came from. But we did send an email, or Ms. Natalie sent an email asking, reply back was Ms. Sandra has the authority to authorize that. I didn't put under their specific language under the direction of myself or the chief deputy, but I thought that had all been resolved.
Well, we kind of thought that it had, except right now it's wide open, and you were asked whether there was any limitation on that, either a dollar limitation or as to some certain set of classification that you didn't want her to move. And we did not get an answer on that.
Judge, I'm going to object. I appreciate Mr. Fry trying to resolve ongoing issues, but it's not relevant to this litigation.
Well, I think it is. He's brought it up over and over.
you brought it up, your witness has, and I think I'm entitled to get some clarification on that, because it's not just going forward.
I'll allow it, let's address it and go on.
So the simple answer is she's authorized to do that.
Correct, yes.
No limitations. Thank you. Please bear with me just a minute. You mentioned.
Let me ask, how much longer you think you're going to be able to pause?
I would think about 10 minutes.
Well, I have a little pause here, and read across as well. I think a lunch recess here. We'll take 45 minutes, which is nominally, nominally 45, 1 to 10, I shall. So we will recommence at 2 o'clock.
Thank you, sir.
So I told you something.